Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Cody, are you live?
Cody, do you want to go live?
We are now live.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we're live now. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us. My name is Mark Into, and I'm the moderator for tonight's session. And just to let you know, I'm not a planner. I'm actually the manager of public affairs and corporate communications, and we're responsible for community engagement. So that's what tonight is really about. It's about engaging you, our community. So tonight you'll have an opportunity to learn more about a development application proposed for the Smart Center site. The applicant is proposing a phased mixed-use development consisting of four residential towers and around 3,600 square meters of commercial uses. However, the application before us tonight is for phase one of this project only, consisting of two towers and approximately 1,300 square meters of commercial uses. The applicant will provide more detailed information as part of its presentation. So this is an early and informal opportunity for everyone to participate in the planning process and will be followed by a statutory public information meeting at a later date. Once again, this is not a statutory open house. Rather, we're holding tonight's meeting specifically for you because we want to give our residents as much notice and information as possible about this development application. So when we do hold the actual stat meeting, you will have a better understanding of the project and will be able to ask more detailed questions and provide more meaningful feedback. Now, before I continue, I do want to address something that comes up all the time. As a municipality, the City of Pickering is mandated to receive and process every application that comes through its doors. This is standard for every municipality in Ontario. And just because we receive and process an application, it does not mean that we are endorsing it. Rather, we rely on a professional staff and the rigorous planning process that they undertake to guide our decision making. And we rely on you, the public, to provide input and comments. So the more you participate in this process, the more we are able to build a city that reflects our collective vision. And it's through this process of collaboration and consultation, we will build a city that works for all. So representatives from both the developer and the Pickering City Development Department will be available to provide details and answer questions tonight. We also have 11 members of the public who have pre-registered as delegates to speak this evening. And we invite you to email any additional questions to socialmedia@pickering.ca. If we can't get to every question during tonight's meeting, staff will personally follow up on all inquiries within two business days. Also with us tonight are our Ward 3 councillors, Regional Councillor David Pickles, City Councillor Shaheen Butt, and from our City Development Department is our Chief Planner, Catherine Rose, the Development Review and Urban Design Manager, Neelesh Surti, and our Principal Planner, Christina Celebre. And with us from the applicant, the developer, is Paula Boustard, Executive Vice President, Smart Centers. Now, before we start, I ask all the panelists to please mute your microphones to minimize any echoing and feedback, and unmute when you are ready to speak. So, to our councillors, ever since Sobeys closed down, I know there has been a lot of talk in our community about the future of this site. And I'm sure there are a lot of differing opinions about what they would like to see. Councillor Pickles, would you like to start off with some comments?
Thank you, Mark. And I'd just like to welcome everybody that's on the line and is participating, both those who are viewing, those who plan to speak. I just want to echo that this is early in the planning process. In fact, this is kind of a voluntary or a bonus meeting that the ward council has requested and that the applicant volunteered and agreed. So I appreciate that. It is a good opportunity for informal discussion and getting some of the obvious questions out of the way. I did note on Facebook there were a lot of questions coming up. Please email them in because our staff don't monitor Facebook. Some of them were good questions. There was some incorrect information in there, so hopefully we can get some of that straightened out tonight. You know, and I think we're going to talk a little bit about housing choices and guidelines from the province for increased density and less greenfield growth and less dependence on cars and more efficient use of infrastructure. And just talking about infrastructure, I know a lot of people were interested in that, and it's maybe good to update that, you know, we have a new ambulatory care or small hospital coming on board. We have a new fire station in the area, a new school, and a proposed new youth senior center and library. So those are a couple of the points I noted people raised. But again, this is very early in the process and just an opportunity for an exchange of information. And that's what we're looking forward to tonight. So thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Councillor Pickles. Councillor Butt, is there something you'd like to add?
Yes, Mark. Again, I want to welcome everybody out as well. And I echo Councillor Pickles' remarks. And I think Pickering is growing at a fast pace now. And I think I have received a few emails myself in regards to people about mixed feelings about the project. What I want to state is, you know, have an open concept. You know, this is interesting. It looks, you know, there's a lot of opportunities for everybody to be in our city here. So I echo this, and I think this tonight here will give a little more information to most residents about what this project is all about.
Thank you, Councillor Butt. And once again, I do want to give credit to yourself and Councillor Pickles. This is not a statutory open house. This is something that we're doing above and beyond because, you know, we want to give, you know, the Ward 3 residents and residents across the city, you know, an early opportunity to review the application before us and give them more time to understand what's being proposed so they can provide meaningful feedback and detailed questions when there is an actual statutory open house taking place, which is probably going to be in the next couple of months. So now I want to introduce the Manager of Development Review and Urban Design, Neelesh Surti, who'll be making a presentation on the planning process. So Neelesh, he's my go-to in the city development department. Whenever I have a planning or development question, I always knock on Neelesh's door and he's available to answer my questions. So he's been the manager for the past 8 years, and he's worked on a lot of key development proposals, and he's a staunch advocate for responsible and sensible development. So Neelesh, please go ahead.
I think Neelesh is on mute.
Thanks, Mark, for the introductions and kind words. Once again, as Mark mentioned, my name is Neelesh Surti, and I'm the Manager of Development Review and Urban Design with the City Development Department at the City of Pickering. The purpose of tonight's electronic public open house meeting is to provide an early informative opportunity for residents to participate in the planning process. I will be providing a brief overview of the planning approval process. In addition, I will also be providing a brief overview of the Kingston Road corridor and specialty retailing node intensification study, which was recently endorsed by Pickering City Council back in December 2019. Following my presentation, Paula Bustard from Smart Center will provide an overview of their proposal. The Planning Act is the basis of Ontario's land use planning system. The Planning Act also sets out the tools that are used to control development or redevelopment. These tools include official plan, zoning bylaws, site plan control, draft plan of subdivision, minor variances, and division. The Planning Act also sets out the process for reviewing each of these applications. Every landowner has the right to submit an application to request a change to land use designation or a change to the zoning of the property. As a municipality, we are mandated to accept and process every application that is formally submitted to the city. However, as Mark mentioned, this should not be confused with endorsement of the application. There are various professional staff that are involved in the rigorous planning review process, and we rely on their input to help guide a final decision. The flow chart on your screen summarizes the planning review process for an official plan amendment and bylaw amendment. Over the next few slides, I will be providing further details regarding each step of the planning approval process. The initial step in the planning approval process is the pre-consultation and the submission of an application. Under the Planning Act, the Planning Act requires that the applicant is to consult with the city prior to the submission of a development application. The purpose of the pre-consultation is for the city and the relevant external agencies to determine what materials and studies are required to review the application. For this particular project, a formal pre-consultation meeting was held back on August 12, 2019 to discuss the proposal as well as to determine the submission requirements. The formal applications were submitted on April 20, 2020, and the city deemed the applications complete on June 5, 2020. In support of the applications, the applicant has prepared and submitted various information and studies, including detailed architectural plans, planning rationale, traffic assessment, phasing plan, engineering drawings, shadow studies, wind study, and noise study, just to name a few. All of the submitted information is available on the city's website for anyone to download and review. Please visit pickering.ca/devapp to download these studies and to review them, and also provide any sort of additional comments that you may have. Once an application is deemed complete, it is circulated to various agencies, boards, and city departments for their detailed technical review. For this particular proposal, the applications have been circulated to the Ministry of Transportation, Toronto and Region Conservation Authority, school boards, Hydro One, various utility providers, including Bell, Rogers, Enbridge. It's also been circulated to various city departments, including planning and design sections, engineering services, fire services, building services, and sustainability. To ensure that residents are fully informed of what is being proposed, all of the technical information and supporting information have been posted on the city's website. Notice of tonight's open house meeting was distributed to residents within 150 meters of the subject lands, and an extended notice was also sent circulated out in consultation with the area councillors. In addition, tonight's open house meeting was also posted on the city's social media accounts, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We encourage you to follow along using the handle @cityofpickering for advertisements of future meetings regarding this proposal. To date, the city has received approximately about 24 written comments from area residents, and the comments include a variety of concerns. And in particular, some of the comments that we've received or concerns that we've received include: the proposal will increase traffic congestions on roads within the surrounding neighborhoods. The building heights are too tall, not appropriate at this location, not compatible with the surrounding established neighborhoods. The proposal will create privacy and shadow impacts on surrounding neighborhoods. The proposal will result in vibration during construction and will impact surrounding homes. Other comments that we've received: that the property is an underutilized site and needs revitalization. The proposal should incorporate wider sidewalks and pedestrian routes, as well as bike lanes. And lastly, buildings should be of high quality design. All the comments that we have received will be considered by staff and will be included in our upcoming information report that will be presented to the Planning and Development Committee in the fall of later this fall. Following tonight's open house meeting, the next step in the planning approval process is the statutory public meeting. We anticipate that this meeting will be held in the fall of 2020. Notices of the statutory public meeting will be distributed to residents within 150 meters of the subject lines, residents who have provided written comments, and who have requested to be notified of all future meetings with respect to this proposal. At the statutory public meeting, residents will have another opportunity to provide their comments to the city. A week prior to the statutory public meeting, planning staff will have an information report available that will summarize the proposal, outline the applicable official plan and related policies, summarize all the concerns that we have received to date from the area residents, summarize comments that we have received from city departments and external agencies, as well as identify the various matters that are required to be addressed. Following the statutory public meeting, staff will provide the applicant with a detailed response to their proposal. It will be the applicant's responsibility to address the various comments and concerns that have been identified through the circulation process, as well as all the comments that we have received from the members of the public as well. Once the applicant resubmits, the updated information is recirculated once again to the various city departments and agencies for review. The updated information is also posted on the city's website. Once the city has completed the review of the application, staff will bring forward a recommendation report for consideration by the Planning and Development Committee and subsequently to Council. Before I ask Paula to provide an overview of their proposal, I'd like to take this opportunity to provide additional information regarding a key study the city has commenced in 2017 with various community engagement sessions that were held over throughout 2018. And in December 2019, the plan was officially endorsed by Pickering City Council. The plan that I'm referring to is referred to as the Kingston Road Corridor and Specialty Retailing Node Intensification Study. The study is intended to prepare a new vision and intensification strategy for all the mixed-use lands located within South Pickering outside of the city center. The boundary of the intensification study is shown on your screen in the red outline, which stretches from the westerly end of Pickering around the City of Toronto border all the way to close to Church Street, if you want to say it, just before Church Street to the east. The lands shown in yellow are located within the Brock precinct, and these are the subject lands that we are discussing today. I'll speak further about the Brock precinct in the next slide. The overall intent of the intensification study is, as I mentioned, is to develop a vision and an intensification strategy. It is intended to try to create a sustainable place that embraces its significant natural heritage features. It's a place to try to create a walkable place within all of the different precincts within the Kingston Road corridor. It is intended to try to create an urban, livable, transit-supported community with a higher density of uses. It's to try to create a place that contributes to serve as both a destination for shopping and a place for employment with retail, commercial services, and offices. And it's also intended to be a place to create a regional and local multimodal connector. The Brock precinct incorporates the portions of the intensification study area around the intersection of Kingston Road and Brock Road, and the entirety of the specialty retailing node located south of Kingston Road, east of Brock Road, and north of Highway 401. The study identifies these lands as mixed use A, which allows for a combination of residential, retail, and office uses. The study also notes that the greatest densities and building heights within the Brock precinct shall be directed to the intersection of Brock Road and Pickering Parkway, with additional concentration along Brock Road and south of Pickering Parkway along Highway 401. Furthermore, the greatest mix of uses are to be located within proximity of the Brock Road and Kingston Road intersection, as well as the Brock Road and Pickering Parkway intersection. The development of major office uses is encouraged in these locations. Lastly, development within the Brock precinct is to be developed as a complete community with transit-supported densities, two public parks, and a distinct community character. As I've noted earlier, in December 2019, Council endorsed in principle the intensification plan and the draft urban design guidelines for the Kingston Road Corridor, especially retailing node study area. The Council also authorize staff to initiate an official plan amendment to implement the vision and intensification plan for the corridor and this node. Staff are currently in the process of preparing official plan amendment to implement the intensification plan. An open house meeting, as well as a statutory public meeting, will be held this fall to obtain input on the recommended policies. In the interim, staff will be considering the recommendations of the council-endorsed intensification plan and the draft urban design guidelines in evaluation of proposals within the intensification areas. If you have any questions regarding the intensification study or would like to participate in any future meetings, please contact Christy Kilmore or Dion Jacobs. Mark, this concludes my presentation this evening.
Thanks, Nilesh. Thanks for that presentation. Recapping some of the points you touched upon, the Kingston Road intensification and the specialty retail node intensification study, that's been going on for the last 2 to 3 years?
That is correct. We commenced the study towards the later half of 2017. We've also had a series of public engagement sessions throughout 2018 to obtain input from the community. And then ultimately a recommendation was provided to council, and it was endorsed by city council in December of 2019.
So even though for tonight is a community engagement session, specifically from Smart Center, but we've been engaging the community about this district for a couple of years now. So that's good to know. Another thing, so I just want to confirm, we're early on in the planning process. This has not gone to council. They have not approved this project. Is that correct?
That is correct. It's early on in the process. We're here to obtain feedback from the public. We want comments from the public, and that will inform the entire planning approval process.
Okay. So as more and more people find out about this project after tonight, what are the other community engagement opportunities?
The next opportunity for community engagement is the statutory public meeting. But having said that, residents are more than welcome to forward their comments into the city. We will endeavor to answer every email questions that we have. The information that we do get today, and as well as subsequently in today's meeting, will be included in our information report, and we'll be presenting that information report to a subsequent planning committee meeting. And information regarding that meeting will be circulated to residents, and there will be an opportunity for them to participate in that meeting as well.
Okay, thanks, Nilesh. And for everyone at home, if you have any questions after Nilesh's presentation, please remember to email us at socialmedia@pickering.ca. And if there's time left, if not running late, we'll try and get to those questions as well too. But if we can't, a staff person will get back to you within the next 2 business days. So now I want to introduce the Executive Vice President of Smart Centers, Paula Bustard. She's going to provide the viewers with a detailed look at the plan that they had submitted to the city for its consideration. Paula?
Thank you very much, Mark and Nilesh. Paula Bustard with Smart Centers. It's nice to virtually meet everyone. I am going to share our presentation and just walk you through a little bit more detail about the site. I will keep our comments relatively brief so we can obviously hear from the public and answer any questions that you may have, but I will just reiterate the comments that have been made by many people tonight. We recognize this is very early in the process. We've just made our complete application, and we look forward to hearing lots of feedback and working collaboratively with all parties. Myself and my team, Michael Guberman and Matt Kruger from Smart Centers are online with me tonight, and subsequent to this meeting, we'd be happy to hear directly from anybody and answer any questions you have and have any further meetings that would be necessary. The site, I think we've established, is at Brock Road and just north of the 401. I think it's a well-known site in the area. And obviously, it's a 40-acre commercial site right now. It was developed, obviously, for large format retail. It is there's a Walmart and a Lowe's on the site. As was earlier mentioned, the Sobeys did close recently. And so it is a large retail site, and we've been looking at obviously intensification opportunities across our portfolio. And we have been an active participant in the Kingston Road intensification study. which obviously was promoting intensification and mixed use development. So through conversations, obviously with the city and working with our consulting team, we've been trying to determine what the most appropriate phase one for this development would be. And there was discussions previously where we were going to make an application on the entirety of the lands. We decided that that probably wouldn't be appropriate at this stage. The retail is not going anywhere. The Walmart, the Lowe's, those are longer term assets on the property. But we do feel that there is an opportunity for intensification in the shorter term at the corner of Pickering Parkway and Brock Road. And we believe this can be done in a very synergistic way to blend the residential in with the commercial components. So I just want to set that stage as we walk through here. And again, happy to get into more details. The existing site, as we've talked about, there's a Lowe's, a Walmart, and there's a mix of retail throughout the property. The parcel that we are looking at is at the corner of Pickering Parkway and Brock Road, and would require the relocation and demolition of some of the retail that is on the property right now. The area in the greater context, I think Neelish did a great job in obviously setting the stage. I don't think we need to go into too much detail here, but obviously the site is surrounded by a mix of uses, including residential, retail, and obviously Highway 401 to the south. And these are just some snippets of some applications and planning and processes that are happening in the adjacent area, including the Kingston Road Corridor Study, Pickering City Center, the Metropia application in Durham Live, just to name a few. And again, just setting context of our site in those other processes. So as I mentioned before, we've done some brainstorming and with our architects and with our design team on what the overall vision for the site could be and how it could be phased. And that's really in light of the fact of the intensification study that was initiated by the city. We're looking at a green spine through the site and developing blocks that can be thoughtfully developed over time and integrated and can coexist with the retail on the property as well. So this was some sketches that were done early on just about the overall land use of the property. But phase one is really what we determined would be the most appropriate application. And we are looking at a 6-acre parcel that we refer to as block one to do an official plan amendment and a zoning bylaw amendment to bring in the residential permissions. And that is the four towers that you see on the page here and roughly 1600 units. The area outlined in blue is what we refer to as phase one, and we made a formal site plan application for phase one. So we did not make site plan application for the towers closest to the Walmart there. And phase one is 737 units fronting on Brock Road. And I'll get into a little bit more detail about that. And again, just in the context of the master plan, we have not made any formal application for the totality of the master plan, but we did this exercise really just to look at the general layout, the open space, the continuity, the access points, and to test a lot of the technical studies in terms of servicing, access, circulation, cycling, and all of those details obviously can be found in our technical studies, which are online. So in a little more specificity about phase one, tower one is 33 stories, tower two, 34 stories. As I indicated, there's 737 units supported on a common podium. There is an outdoor space on level four. And the site is serviced internal. So the existing access point off of Brock Road and Pickering Parkway will be utilized to bring traffic and circulation into the site, which I'll go through in a moment. Again, vehicular access movement, which I just mentioned, Pickering Parkway, access point off of Brock Road and through the interior streets and access points to bring you into the residential. And that will work seamlessly with the existing existing commercial on the property. Pedestrian and cycling movements will also be designed to allow for porosity through the property, access to transit stops, and to provide seamless connections to the adjacent parcels. High level, I touched on this. Block one is 6.5 acres. Phase one is 2.62 acres within that 6.5 acres. And again, roughly the gross floor area is roughly 1.5 million for the OP and zoning for the entirety of the block. But phase one, which we are seeking site plan approval, is 650,000 square feet and 737 units. We are working on the downtown parking rates of roughly 0.8 for residential unit plus 0.15 for visitor parking. This is a ground floor plan. We are creating a common podium here with retail uses activating Pickering Parkway, townhomes activating Brock Road and the interior road with open space, obviously along the interior street, that will provide about 0.32 acres of open space. As I mentioned before, all of the circulation, access, garbage, loading, all happens interior to the site and does not come off of any of the arterial roads, which will help a lot of the traffic flows. And the floor plates and the mix of uses are still being obviously worked on and pending final comment from the city. But we are looking at a mix of bedroom sizes and units within this tower. The architect of this project is Turner Fletcher Architects, and we really want to make this an interesting and beautiful architectural building within the neighborhood. There is going to be a significant outdoor amenity space also on the fourth floor and green roofs. And that is a rendering, obviously looking at the proposal. And with that, my contact information will be available on the screen now, and we will obviously provide it at the end of this presentation. I sincerely welcome anyone to reach out to me and to my team, obviously tonight, but following this presentation, we'd be happy to engage in any conversations, and we look forward to working collaboratively with all parties. So thank you very much for your time, and I very much look forward to hearing your comments. Thank you.
Paula, thanks so much for your presentation. So now it's time to hear from our delegates, and tonight we have 10 delegates, and they've been pre-registered in accordance with the notice that went out. And in order to facilitate discussion and hopefully get answers to whatever questions they may have, we're asking that the delegates keep their comments to about 10 minutes. For those of you watching live on our YouTube channel, you might think of something to ask one of our panelists, so please feel free to email your questions to socialmedia@pickering.ca. And once again, if we're not running late, we're going to try and get to your questions tonight, and otherwise we'll get back to you in 2 business days. So do we have our delegates online now?
Yes, hi.
Hi, who are you speaking with?
My name's Jacqueline Beasley.
I live Hi, Jacqueline.
Across from Brock, hi.
Please go ahead.
Okay, the size of this development is excessively large for a family suburban community. And so my point of concern, as I'm sure other residents feel the same, is the traffic study was not conducted in the documentation that was provided by the developer, saying it was the timing was bad because of COVID. You can't have a development of this magnitude or the scale without having a proposal, or excuse me, without an official traffic study. We particularly, in the month of December, on Pickering Parkway specifically, and the lead off onto Brock and other areas, have gridlock at this time. And at this time, they're already developing around Pickering Parkway at the mall side of Pickering Town Center, as well as the casino coming in the mix in a little while, but right now on Pickering Parkway, there's a development for condominiums that are in a build process, as well as changes to the mall itself. So that's already going to be added and compounded with the high peak traffic that already exists in the months of December as the Christmas season approaches. So it's a huge concern with implementing a build that is essentially for a skyscraper, something you even rarely see in Toronto of that height. The amount of traffic that would be implemented and caused by this size of this build is just going to overtake the neighboring streets. I also had reached out to the mayor just to add to that concern of the traffic, and an email I got back from the mayor was that the traffic would have to be routed, or rather the Brock Road would have to be changed, as well as the access point to Highway 401. So with all these changes, it's not just a case of plopping in the buildings, it's a case of having to make structural changes to the roadways and the access to the 401. And with other builds going on in the proposed casino a little bit further down towards church, the traffic, again, back to the traffic concern, is just going to be complete gridlock I don't think new people moving into a condominium complex would be feeling very happy about that, because they have to travel to get to work, get home, do groceries, shopping, all those things. So that's my big concern, the fact that the traffic is going to be impacted so greatly because of the magnitude and scale of the build, and the fact that a traffic study hasn't even been conducted at this point. So, you know, assimilation software is not the same. It's, you know, for lack of a better phrase, forgive the term, junk science. You need to have real hard, raw data in order to even propose the traffic aspect of this build. So that is the main concern that I have.
Okay, thanks, Jacqueline. Paula, do you want to provide some comment on the traffic studies or forthcoming traffic studies?
Yeah, absolutely. And I absolutely acknowledge that the timing of when the technical studies were going to be done were right in the middle of when COVID obviously hit the world. And there's obviously no proxy sites and no technical work that could be done at that point. There was no one on the roads. We were all obviously in quarantine. So we do acknowledge, we did do obviously some desktop analysis that was submitted. Additional work is forthcoming and will be submitted, and we'll be working obviously with all the agencies. So we are not skirting any responsibility in terms of doing detailed traffic analysis. It obviously is a critical issue, and we will continue to supplement that information as possible. We're still waiting for the world to kind of get a little bit back to normal to ensure that the data that we are looking at is appropriate and meeting the proper methodology. So I hear you completely on that. That being said, there is a lot of good historical data that I, you know, respectfully would disagree is junk science. And we would be happy to work with yourself and walk through with our consultants. So this is ongoing work, and we will look at all the issues that you raised. Obviously, with the displacement of some retail, there is some components that you have to look at in terms of the lost square footage of retail and how that changed traffic patterns in the area. But that being said, we will provide some more additional information, and we'd be happy to meet with the community on that as it becomes available. So thank you.
Okay, thanks, Paula. This question is for Catherine Rose, our chief planner. So in order for the city to evaluate this this development application, we need those traffic studies, right? We're not going to make any decision, or staff are not going to make any decision without those traffic studies. Is that correct?
Mark, that's correct. Recognize this was a very unusual time, and you know they were interested in submitting their application, and who knows how long it will be before we actually get those real-time traffic counts. Hopefully it'll be within the next 6 months, but we will wait for the appropriate studies to be done, and we'll consider those before we bring a recommendation back to council.
Okay, and Jacqueline made a very good point. So it's not just smart centers, but it's all this other development taking place in Pickering. How does our city development department take all of those into account?
Again, Mark, we would require the terms of reference for the traffic study to identify all of the what the existing background traffic is, all of the development proposals which are in the queue, and anticipate what their contribution would be to increase traffic. I believe it's usually for a 5-year and possibly a 10-year forecast, and then add the new development to that and identify the impacts. So that background traffic increase is included.
Okay, perfect. Thanks, Catherine. So our next delegate is Christina Klepinska. Christina, are you on the line?
Yes.
Please go ahead. Thank you.
Most of my concerns were already covered by the previous speaker, but I'm the person who actually lives in this subdivision, and at this very moment, I can tell you how difficult it is to make any turns when you try to go to work. I cannot even imagine when you put the influx of 3,500 people in this very tiny, tiny space, how am I supposed to move with my car up there? There's actually so many traffic lights in such a short distance. And from what I understand, there's another proposal of making changes to Pickering Parkway, and from what I see, I wouldn't be able to make a turn from Marsh Court to make a eastern, I would be able to make to on the westbound turn. How is going to work with adding but 3,000, more than 3,000, because I only multiply, by two, the number of dwellers going to believe over here. And another is, from what that would be nice to see, very clear picture of those maps, because it's really too hard to imagine, so difficult to imagine, because all those maps which are showing over here right now are very, very blurry. And from what Paula mentioned, Walmart would stay up there, according to my understanding, and Lowe's will stay there as well, yeah? So what happened to the other store existing? They're going to disappear? My another question is, I'm very, very concerned with the height of this building. To have in my just backyard 40-store high-rise, I cannot even imagine to have something like that. I moved to this area to have quiet family life, and it's anything but quiet family life, because constantly each and any change which comes into this area is a change for worse. This is really crushing. And when I look at those pictures, according to my knowledge, the very first high-rise right at the junction of Kingston, Brock and Pickering Parkway, would be right up the corner. Is there any space for widening that Brock Road in the future? And to have 40-story building right up there in the corner? And another question is, who will be living in this? Who will be living in these high-rises? Are there any subsidized units? Because this would be my, government subsidized. This would be a big concern for me. And not, have some other question is, so why this, both store, why both buildings have to be so high? Who agrees to this? Like, you know, there's nothing in this neighborhood, entire, I think, Pickering. We don't have high rises, 40 store high. This was very, very unusual. So I guess those are the questions which have not been covered so far from any previous speakers. And I'll be done for today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Christina. Okay, so bye. Have a good evening. So with respect to the maps and the clarity of the maps, I think if you go to our website, pickering.ca/dev-app, which is DEVAPP, we're going to have these planning documents and the maps online. So you can go click on the link and have a better look on your computer. So, you know, this is just a remote technology to help us with this meeting. I know it's not very visible right now, but go to our website afterwards and the information will be there. Now, you also had a question about stores disappearing. So I think that's something that Paula should answer.
Thanks, Mark. Yeah, as I said in my presentation, there will obviously be some reduction of retail on the site, and over time, the retail will be repurposed. But we are, the ultimate vision for the site is a mixed use with residential and retail repurposed into a more urban format. Walmart and Lowe's will be staying, as will the bulk of the retail on the site for the phase one. And as we redevelop in future phases and future applications, we'll be incorporating the retail in the bases of the buildings. There is retail being proposed at the base of this fronting onto Pickering Parkway. So the bulk of the retail on the site will be staying for the foreseeable future and will be integrated with the intensification that we're proposing.
Okay, thanks, Paula. Now, Christina said that a lot of her questions with respect to traffic were answered, but she had specific questions about the ability to make turns going east or west. As part of your planning studies, do you go down to that granular level to show residents how you'd be able to, you know, facilitate, you know, those concerns or address those concerns?
The traffic study looks at turning movements and wait times and intersection capacities. All of that is done through the traffic study. A good amount of information has been submitted, but as I acknowledged, it will be supplemented with additional data when we can do more specific site analysis and traffic counts. But yes, a lot of that information will be provided and has been and will be supplemented with additional backup.
Okay, and Christine had one final question about subsidized housing. Is that something you've considered? Is that part of your marketing mix? Are you even there yet?
Well, we're not totally there yet in terms of, we are proposed that this is going to be a condo. I don't believe that this would be a rental building. We are looking at it as a condo would be to market rates. But obviously, there are aspirations for affordability that Pickering and the region do have. But for the most part, these would be market condos that would go. So I can't speak to subsidization. I don't believe that would be the direction that would be going. But we are looking at, obviously, this being a primarily a condo site for this phase. Great.
Thanks, Paula. So, you know, this isn't directed specifically to Christina, but everyone else on the line. You know, something that we always hear at City Hall is the need for affordable housing, affordable accommodation. So I'm not sure if this project is actually going to address that, but I just want everyone to recognize that there is a legitimate need for that here in our community, and we need to look out for those people who require help in housing, and it's something that we will be trying to address with each development application that comes in, because there is a very real need. So I just wanted to bring that up to everyone's attention. So our next delegate is Adam Rahman. Adam, are you on the line?
Hi, yes, good evening, I am. First of all, I'd just like to say thank you to the city and the developers for joining this virtual town hall. I find it quite helpful myself, and I do hope we can do more of these. My specific question or comment or concern kind of stems in addition to the first two callers that we had. What I'm worried about is the balance of, say, commercial traffic versus residential traffic. I think the condo towers are one thing, but taking a step back, sort of looking at this area, specifically Pickering Parkway, between Brock Road and Notion Road, is where I'm centered or more concerned about. Taking a step back, to look at this thing, we have the Pickering Live coming up, which is going to have some additional traffic at Notion Road. We have the City View development happening just in front of Blue Sky in that vicinity. We have a lot of side streets leading into Pickering Parkway. So what I'm worried about is we currently have a quarry down by Notion Road. And when those trucks come by down Pickering Parkway, it literally shakes our house. Now, the concern was raised all the way back in 2016, and nothing really changed. The trucks still come down here, just with COVID and everything, when construction was allowed to resume. Let me tell you, it felt like a war zone down Pickering Parkway. Like all the glasses in my cupboard, everything would shake. There's a thick layer of dust all over everything in my backyard. I couldn't sit on my deck at all because the diesel, the exhaust fumes, the exhaust from these trucks are higher than the back of my fence, right? So you have these huge earth movers coming down Pickering Parkway. Plus, you're going to have a lot more residential traffic coming down Pickering Parkway. And so my real concern is, in addition to the first two callers, how are we going to manage this as a community? Because we can't have, both commercial traffic flowing down Pickering Parkway from a quarry, plus this additional residential traffic. So I just want to know how these how this sort of macro traffic aspect is being looked at, not just residential traffic, but also the existing commercial traffic.
Thanks, Adam, and thank you for the compliment with respect to community engagement. Like I stated from the onset, it's something that's very important to the mayor and council. There's just so much going on with the city, so we feel an obligation to engage our residents, our stakeholders, as much as possible. So this is a positive first step for us, and thank you for the acknowledgement. So with respect to managing residential traffic and construction traffic, I'm going to leave that to Paula as the developer, because I know they've done a lot of construction, across Canada. So do you want to address that, Paula, please?
Thanks, Mark. I can't speak specifically to the trucks and the quarry issue. I mean, that probably is outside of my expertise. But I will say that anytime that we look at site design, both from the traffic and site organization, you do look at the holistic parameters that are around your site. So you're not doing it in isolation, just saying I'm building residential tower, so I'm only modeling residential traffic. You obviously are looking at what the existing network is, what the adjacent land uses are at different parameters. Obviously, in this case, this is being reviewed by the MTO as well. We're within the MTO review area. So you are looking at the different roads, the different sources of traffic, and obviously the different times of day. So all of that gets analyzed in the traffic report, and all of it also gets looked at when we're doing our site design. And part of that is making sure that you have controlled access points, you have good circulation, that you have good stacking. And that was one of the things I said in the presentation too. We specifically ensured that the primary access point to the underground and to the parking and to the loading and to the garbage for the condos happens on the interior. So that's not happening on the arterial roads, creating stacking and creating more congestion and more issues for conflicts. So all I can say is that part of the traffic analysis that get done looks at everything that's happening into the community and looks at all of those inputs. But I will leave specific comments about issues with the quarry to the city or to someone else to speak to. So hopefully that answers your question. Thank you.
Thanks, Paula. So our next delegate is Balwinder Singh. Balwinder, are you on the line?
We just, Mark, it's Cody Morrison speaking. It seems Mr. Singh dropped off the call there. We'll make efforts to reach back out to him.
Okay.
We do have a Mr. Scott Campbell on the line.
Perfect. Scott, you're on the line. Please go ahead. Thank you.
Hi, Mark. Thanks for taking my call as a delegate. I listened attentively to my regional councillor, David Pickles, when he opened up, and Paula as well, and Mr. Nazlis Surti with the Pickering Development. My concern, as many other callers that have previously spoke to the point, was civil infrastructure. And, you know, David Pickles touched on, civil infrastructure. And when I say civil infrastructure, I am talking primarily roadways. I am talking access to the 401. Okay. So if the city of Pickering wants to grow, if the city of Pickering truly wants to grow, they need to be expanding roadways. If you look at Brampton, they have the 410. Mississauga has the 403. These are major arteries going right through the city centers. And out east in Curtis, they've newly added the 418. Now, what off-ramps do we have in the city of Pickering? We only have White's Road and Brock Road. And let me tell you, Brock Road, when you're coming from Toronto into the Durham region, is a disaster. It is gridlocked. It is bottlenecked. People are sitting on that off-ramp waiting to make a left-hand turn to go northbound on Brock Road for miles. It sometimes takes 20 minutes to make that left-hand turn to go north on Brock Road. It is a disaster. And if you think adding more residential condo towers at Pickering Parkway and Brock Road is a good idea, it is not a good idea. You do not need a traffic study, because you could just ask local residents. People have to deal with this. It is gridlock on the Pickering Parkway, as another local resident already noted. And you guys, you know, are adding to the problem. Now, Paula has an agenda here, right? She's working on behalf of a company, right? You are a retail investment trust company, and you are trying to offset retail into mixed residential. Why is that? Because there's a retail crisis. Stores are closing. Well, if stores are closing and you cannot get commercial renters, why don't you change your investment and your commercial space that you do have, as this Smart Centers REIT, and why, like, as a suggestion, You know, why don't you just put a Costco there? Why don't you keep it retail? Why did the Sobeys close? Because you're trying to diversify commercial space into residential. You do not need to add more people in a neighborhood that is already maxed out congestion-wise. It is very hard to even move around to get to where you need to get to. We do not have a subway. We do not have any real good transit. So people in Ajax, Pickering area are heavily reliant on their ability to drive from place to place. So there is no walkability whatsoever, right? And so adding multi-use development, you're basically curtailing the fact that right now we're just going to take away some retail stores, but this is just phase one, right? Maybe 5 years, 10 years down the line, maybe then we might get rid of Lowe's, we might get rid of Walmart in phase two or three. This is not a good move in my view. And ultimately, once you start the ball rolling on this, it's just going to get worse and worse down the line. So primarily, Pickering needs to address the civil infrastructure. And speaking to that point, it's interchanges, it's adding more possibilities of arteries, highways, on-ramps, off-ramps, bridges, tunnels over the 401, Clover-style interchanges that streamline entrances and off-ramps from Toronto. Mark, that's my point. Thank you.
Scott, thanks so much for your comments. Just to address some of the infrastructure comments you made, the 407 Whites Road interchange should be open probably late fall, early winter. So that's coming up. With respect to Liverpool Road, there, I don't know if you remember, but there used to be an exit off of Liverpool Road. And I'm not sure the reasons why. Maybe Catherine can update us, but that was taken away. And it's something that I know the mayor and council have been asking to have reinstated, but we haven't had a lot of success. With respect to a Cloverleaf and other off-ramps and tunnels and bridges, you know, that's not the city of Pickering alone. That requires, you know, the commitment from the province of Ontario and the funding as well. So I'm not sure, Catherine, is there anything you want to add to that?
Thank you, Mark. I can just advise that when the it was the eastbound off-ramp was eliminated, it was because of the expansion to the train tracks that were serving the GO station. And by the time they extended the bridge to accommodate those tracks, there was no room left for a ramp to come up and intersect with Liverpool before basically being intersecting with Bailey. We have had some reviews done looking at the possibility of, or looking at what the impacts would be of trying to get another eastbound off ramp. And it basically requires a lot of land from the Bay Ridges neighborhood at the southwest corner of Liverpool and Bailey. So where you've got commercially, I think there's there's Tim Hortons and some other uses to the south, or you have to come back in closer to the head of Frenchman's Bay with very short button hooks. Again, from a safety standpoint, basically it's a ramp like we have for the Whites Road, the ones that come up like about wishbone. They would result in a lot of stacking on the 401 to get off, and therefore they are not preferred. So it is a challenge, as there is no sort of obvious vacant land that could be used for those ramps.
Okay. Thanks, Catherine. Paula, Scott had some specific retail questions, and maybe, you know, looking at your retail model, I don't know if you want to address that.
I don't think there's much to address in there. I mean, with all due respect, our business strategy is our business strategy, but we are doing intensification and diversification of our portfolio across the country. This is not a one-off. We're doing a substantial amount of residential development, and we're looking at markets where it makes sense, where we can obviously integrate it in a seamless way and have a holistic design for the center. And as I said in my presentation, the retail will probably change over the coming years, but the only application that's before us now is what we've presented. So hopefully that answers.
Okay, thanks, Paula. Our next delegate is Abu Jermaine Konati. Abu, are you on the line?
Mark, Cody Morrison speaking. We did make the connection with Mr. Konate, and he advised that his
questions
have been answered.
Yes.
And Mr. Alan Jeff is the next available delegate.
Perfect. Alan, are you there right now?
I am. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Please go ahead. Thank you.
Thanks, Cody. Thanks, Chair Gwynthill and Councillors Pickleton Butt, Ms. Rose. I imagine Christine is on the line, and Mr. Surdy, and thanks to Ms. Bustard and her two colleagues who have joined us tonight. I appreciate the opportunity to address you. I'm a 27-year resident of Durham Reach, and I live on Royal Road with my wife, and we're about 2.5 blocks from the subject property. For tonight's open house, I've prepared 5 questions for the applicant and 1 for the city staff. That will allow me to better understand the applicant's proposed plans for their property. I'm not looking to hear tonight to make comments without understanding things better. So I'll read these questions into the public record this evening with a view to having written responses to each of these questions provided back to everyone well in advance of the statutory public meeting with the Planning and Development Committee. I'm not looking for answers tonight, unlike maybe some of the other delegates. And I'll forward these questions on to Christina and planning staff there likely tomorrow. So the first 5 questions are for the folks from Smart Centers, the applicants. The first relates to their long-term plans, which they touched on here, but my questions tend to be perhaps more specific than what might have been mentioned before. So I want to understand the applicant's intent relative to their entire Smart Centers property holdings, including for their property that accommodates the former Sobeys store, the LCBO, the Dollarama, and PetSmart stores, the Lowe's and the Walmart. And I'd like to know what are the cancellation and notice provisions for your business arrangements with the 5 of those that are still active on the property, specifically LCBO, Dollarama, PetSmart, Lowe's, and Walmart. So that's my first question. The second question relates to the key metrics. My question is this: so that an apples and apples comparison can be conducted with other Pickering developments using the city's standard definitions for density and units per net hectare and for floor space index FSI, and not using the proposed bylaw definitions that the applicant has advanced. What are the density and FSI numbers for the initial proposal of the so-called phase 1? And what are the approximate density and FSI numbers for any future towers with the proposed maximum height of 43 stories that the applicant is looking for? The third question relates to the applicant's marketing plan. There were some questions in this regard earlier. In the marketing plan for these first 2 towers, what is the target demographic of the purchasers that the applicant will be seeking to attract? And what is the nature of the retail establishments that the applicant will be seeking to attract to their retail spaces? So, you know, we've heard about what's leaving, but what's coming? I have 2 questions related to parking, one related to residential parking and one related to retail parking. The question relating to residential parking is a 3-part question. So your proposal includes a provision for both on-site and off-site parking for the residents. Why is off-site parking required? The second question, what rationale or justification does the applicant have for a residential parking ratio of 0.8 vehicles per unit when you exclude the visitors parking? And the third question relating to residential parking, do you expect that this residential parking ratio will restrict the marketability of residential sales to your target demographic? You know, if you identify the target demographic in number 3, will that or will that not restrict your ability to market to that demographic, and why or why not. Regarding retail parking, you have proposed a retail parking allotment of one space for 100 meters squared of gross leasable floor area for food, personal service, and retail locations. As part of your rationale or justification for this parking ratio, could you please outline how this parking allotment which needs to accommodate both the staff and customers of these establishments, is supportive of a retail firm running a profitable retail business on this site with those ratios? And then once again, in a similar vein as to what I asked about the residential, do you expect that this target retail parking ratio will restrict your ability to lease your retail space to your intended retail clients as you identify them in the third question? Why or why not? And then I have a question. So that's the five questions I have for the applicant. I have one question for the city at this point. Again, I'll forward all of these to Christina tomorrow. As this proposal seemingly initiates the stepwise dismantling of the retail establishments on the Smart Center properties located within both the Brock Precinct and the so-called specialty retailing node as part of the Kingston Road Corridor plan, please advise us of how this proposal aligns with the stated intensification plan objective, which is clearly outlined on page 13 of the intensification plan, which asserts that this specialty retailing node, and I'm quoting here, serves a regional role, providing specialty retailing to a broad regional market, close quote. So how are these changes and the impact on retail aligning with that objective? And then in addition, please elaborate on what plans the city has undertaken to accommodate the shopping needs of our ever-growing population in a location nearby? Or will the residents of East Pickering have to become reliant upon and travel to neighboring communities like Ajax for our essential day-to-day and week-to-week shopping needs? So those are the six questions. I'll send them down the wire. I really honestly have no interest in hearing replies. I'd much rather receive, you know, written replies down the road when people offer a clear answer. The opportunity, by the way, to capitalize on what Ms. Buster had already suggested. I'm more than happy to deal with any parties directly where that would be helpful. And I look forward to seeing the written reply well in advance of the public meeting. Happy to also chat with city representatives. I've already opened up the conversation here with Christina also representatives of the applicant as warranted. Thank you very much.
Alan, thanks so much. Those are incredibly well thought out questions, and that's exactly why we're doing this open house tonight, so you can get the answers to these questions. So when it's time for the statutory open house, you know, you can provide more meaningful feedback. So thanks, excellent job. Now, our next delegate is Kathleen St. Hilaire Treston. Kathleen, are you on the line?
I am.
Thank you. Kathleen, please go ahead.
Okay, some of the questions that I had have been covered. The main one was the traffic. As I am a resident of Pickering Parkway, we've got seven townhouses that have direct access onto Pickering Parkway, and it's extremely difficult to be able to get in or out of our driveways. The traffic is constantly flowing. Right now, because of the pandemic, there's the volume of people traveling on the 401 has been somewhat reduced. Under normal circumstances, in the evenings, it's impossible, and weekends, impossible to get in and out of the driveways because the traffic coming from the 401, when the traffic is backed up, people come off White's Road, Liverpool, and they race across Pickering Parkway. It's a constant flow of traffic. It's backed up as far back to Valley Farm sometimes. when we moved here 25 years ago, we were able to just walk, you know, make a choice of driving or walking. Now, on a weekend, forget about taking the cars out because you cannot get out. In the evenings, you cannot get out. We also have a large number of seniors in our senior homes and also our aging population. My concern is the seniors that cross the street as well as children crossing the street on an ongoing basis to the little variety store that's at Pickering Parkway in Denmark. You know, how many accidents are we going to have down the road? We also have accidents on a weekly basis at Brock and Pickering Parkway. So, you know, what's all this other traffic going to do for us? Not only the high rises that are coming on the corner of Brock and Pickering Parkway, but the townhouses that are being built just a little further down close to Notion Road. So, you know, we're just adding more and more traffic onto Pickering Parkway with no real consideration. And my question, my other question here is in reference to the fire departments. Are our fire departments going to be ready to rescue residents in a 32-story building? And when will every fire department be updated with their equipment to handle these high rises? And why do we need these high rises in the middle of Pickering? You know, I mean, we were 9 stories, we went to 13, suddenly it went to 16. There was no announcement about it going to 16. Then, you know, now it's not 20, but 34, 32, 40. Where is this going to stop? The Emerald Condominium, when that building was going up there, they've had so many buildings because most of the lands around here are built on clay anyway. So, you know, we have problems in the area with the terrain, and those are things that need to be considered as well. When there's any heavy traffic, as one of our other callers had mentioned, any heavy-duty traffic on the street rumbles the road. It feels like an earthquake. We need to start looking at providing more services for the existing residents, like parks, sidewalks. All our sidewalks are pieces of sidewalks because we're waiting on the next development to finish the sidewalk along the way. So, you know, I think that we need to start looking at completing what we have, provide services that make our residents comfortable and happy, providing more services for our seniors instead of adding to the problems that already exist. And that's what I have to say tonight.
Thanks so much, Kathleen. You know, a lot of your comments revolved around traffic, and it's been a common theme tonight. So that's something that I think we've already discussed at great length. You had a question or a comment about sidewalks and the patchwork nature of sidewalks, and I think you're referring to Highway 2, Kingston Road. So Highway 2 is actually a regional road, and with respect to the urbanization of Kingston Road, it's an ongoing process with the region, and I think you're correct that, you know, they'll build the sidewalks as development or intensification occurs on Kingston Road. Kathy or Nilesh, are you able to add something to that?
Sure, I'll weigh in. Actually, the challenge with a road like Kingston Road is that it's actually the city's responsibility to provide the sidewalks along Kingston Road. So we do, we certainly do, when there's a development application, get that developer to build the sidewalk. We also have to put in the additional light standards for the street, for the overhead street lights. But I do believe it has been a constant request of a number of councillors to get a program in our budget where we do fill in some of those gaps. And I'm thinking of Councillor Pickles, and perhaps he may want to provide some additional comment because I think he's been a very strong advocate of a city-initiated program to complete those sidewalk gaps.
Thanks for the clarification, Catherine. Councillor Pickles, are you still on the line?
Hi, Mark. Thanks, it's Catherine. Yeah, I mean, Kingston Road was a rural road, so we're starting from a road that has ditches and culverts. So as development comes along, we are trying to fill in those gaps, if you will. Along with the transit that's being improved along that route, we're going to see some of those spots fixed up with sidewalks. I know that we have a bit of a pinch point down closer to or between Liverpool and Whites, where we have the railway crossing, and there's a number of engineering solutions being looked at that. A number of years ago, myself and Councillor McLean as well had been lobbying very hard to try and get sidewalks on both sides of Kingston Road from Toronto to Ajax. We've got a few more gaps to accomplish, but we're trying to add them in with the city's plans and transit plans and development plans and our own budget. So we're working on it, and then there's still some spots to be filled in.
Okay.
Mark, I just wanted to way back in because the region of Durham is actually undertaking a review of its official plan, and one of the discussion papers was about transportation, and they are now recognizing the approach to streets as being complete streets that would provide the ability not just to drive a car on it, but to have a safe bicycle lane, to have sidewalks. So we're hoping that actually filters through into their budgeting and planning for road construction.
Okay, thanks, Catherine. So with respect to some of the other condominium developments in Pickering, with respect to upgrading our fire services to ensure they have the proper equipment in an emergency, is that part of the consideration when we evaluate these development applications? Nilesh, I don't know if you want to answer that.
Thanks, Mark. Absolutely. As we continue to grow as a city and the types of housing forms that are provided are as part of our budgeting and planning for providing emergency access is certainly taken into consideration as we continue to grow. And depending on the type of housing forms, we will certainly look at the type of equipment that will be best needed to serve for emergency services to these buildings.
Okay, thank you, Nilesh. So we're now on our second last delegate, is Owen Malcolm on the line.
Hello, thank you for everybody attending the meeting and Mark for moderating the meeting. I'm the resident at 1883 Ashford Drive, literally across the Good Life and directly behind Walmart. I have about six questions. Mark, again, thank you for moderating. And if you can make a note of them, they're pointed. My first and foremost question, is there a long-term plan, a vision as per se, for the city? That's my biggest question. Or is the plan that builders simply can look to make applications and submit projects based on the existing zoning per project or per land? My concern for this question is that there really is no vision, long-term plan for the city of Pickering, as you know, I was basically grew up here, and as I see projects go up and come down, unlike bigger cities like Washington, I look at Denver. I mean, of course, the U.S. is not in good shape right now, but they have a long-term plan. When you drive around the city, you've got many roadways, transit, and as these large projects go up, I'm wondering if there's a long-term plan, and it doesn't appear to be a long-term vision, but just as builders come in with projects. So if you could please talk about that and give some insight into what that looked like, or if one does exist. My second question, please elaborate on the phase one and if there is an objective to remove the Walmart and Lowe's by the time phase four is complete. I know, Paula, correct me if I'm wrong, you talked about phase one, and you alluded to not touching the Walmart and Lowe's in phase one, but what does that look like after phase four is complete? If you can talk about that in detail. The third question, I'm seeing this rendering for four buildings, but nowhere in the rendering does it include the larger side of the police station and even the Pickering Town Center for that matter. And again, this points to my initial question in one, what's the long-term vision of the city? Why are we only seeing these four projects? I'm not seeing Walmart. So that's my question. Question number four, does this project take into account the following? Does a project to build a bridge at the end of Pickering Parkway and Notion Road to connect trafficway going to the casino? As I sit here listening to this presentation, I have not heard anyone speak about that bridge going across the highway at Pickering Parkway and Notion Road. As you drive down, as you drive south on Pickering Parkway, you can make the left onto Notion, but they're looking to make a bridge going right over the bridge. If we can talk about that in depth, I'd greatly appreciate that. And if that project is still ongoing or in the planning, and is it factored into the planning of this site? Lastly, again, this points to question one. Please talk about the commercial space at the Pickering Town Center versus the said site we're talking about this evening. Are the two competing for retail space against one another, or are we looking to create a downtown core of some sort? Lastly, Scott, you commented on Cloverleaf. It might be completely irrelevant. What is it, if you might shed some light on it, that would be great. And again, most importantly, what is the long-term plan for this city? Thank you for your time.
Thanks so much, Owen. So your main question about the long-term plan or vision for the city, I'm going to ask our chief planner, Catherine Rose, to address.
So thank you, Mark. The long-term vision for the city is spelled out in the city's official plan. And that official plan is reviewed every 5 years. And we have been going through a series of amendments looking at different issues. Some of them were related to the rural area, the natural environment and countryside. We did a review of the intensification for the city center, and this most recently, the Kingston Road Corridor and specialty retailing nodes center study was to set the vision for, generally it's like the next 20 years, for what that corridor will look like. And we're going through that implementation. So cities evolve over time. They're not static. There isn't a single plan that you put in place and that is the plan. We're constantly evolving and updating what the vision is based on new conditions. You know, one of the biggest things that happened was the introduction of the provincial growth plan, which set minimum targets for the city to achieve. What we have to achieve in the existing urban area is part of that approach. We can only allow certain development in the greenfield areas. So that caused us to really look at the role of intensification and how we need to introduce that into the city and therefore put in policies that identify the appropriate type of intensification, the controls, the compatibility that we need to look at between existing development and proposed development, but recognizing there is a mandate to intensify within the city.
Thank you, Catherine. You know what? I think that's a very important point to make. I think you're referring to Ontario Places to Grow, which came out in 2005. And basically, you know, the province laid out this plan that when development occurs in Ontario, we have to meet certain intensification targets, including the city of Pickering. I'm not sure, I think it's 40% in developed areas. So basically when we get these applications, we just can't shut the door and say, no, we don't want any developments. You know, we're a creature of the province. We're part of Durham Region, and Durham Region has this growth plan. And based on those two plans, development has to occur. But what we can do is influence that type of development and have our say, you know, look at the studies and the reports. But I'm not sure people are aware that, you know, the province says you have to grow, you have to intensify. And basically that's what we're trying to accommodate. And that's what we're trying to, you know, our residents, our stakeholders and businesses. Now, Owen had another question about Notion Road. So Nilesh, are you able to provide us an update on Notion Road?
Yes, Mark, Notion Road is, we've recently completed an environmental assessment for the Notion Road overpass, which connects Notion Road to Squires Beach. The EAA process has been completed for it. We are in the process of looking at the detailed design. So the project is moving forward. It will take some time to eventually implement, but it isn't contingent upon this particular development. It is a project that will be moving forward in the near future and will provide for another important north-south link in Pickering and help alleviate some of the traffic issues and congestion sometimes that we see along Brock Road or along particularly Brock Road and the 401 interchange or down towards Bailey or even up on to Brock and Kingston as well. So I think it will be another vital link that once it is constructed, but it is a project that is moving forward and it isn't something that is tied to this particular application.
Okay, thanks, Nilesh. Owen, I apologize. I know you had a couple of other questions, but we're at our 10-minute limit, and we still have one more remaining delegation. So, Owen, if you want to send us an email at socialmedia@pickering.ca, we'll try and get those other questions answered within the next couple of days. So our final delegate is Stephen Gilchrist. Steve, are you on the line?
I am indeed. Good evening.
Good evening. Thank you.
Ready to go if you are. That's super. Good evening to councillors and staff. You know, it's almost exactly 1 year ago today, and I was amongst the speakers who offered critical comments about the plan by the city to allow the demolition of the Sears wing of the Pickering Town Center and to allow the rezoning of those commercial lands to high-density residential. I noted at the time that it was rumored the same fate would soon befall the Smart Center lands at 1899 Brock Road. It's essential these two planning decisions be seen together, since the aggregate impact of the loss of such a staggering percentage of the retail space in our city will have an equally significant and negative impact on our quality of life and the value of our homes. I've been involved in urban planning issues in a variety of fashions for over 30 years. I've made a point to familiarize myself with as much of the science underlying the allocation of land to various uses as I could. As I noted last year, every single study on the subject of the relationship of commercial land to residential land has concluded there's a positive impact once you get beyond the immediate neighbors of a commercial property. In other words, aside from the homes that would face or back onto 1899 Brock Road, there is an increase in the value of the homes as a result of the convenience of being near a shopping center. It was absolutely one of the two largest determinants of why I bought where I did buy back 16 years ago. And it's somewhat beyond ironic that at the same time the city put such a major emphasis on green initiatives, such as bike lanes and increased bike use, it is considering the deliberate and significant undermining of the ability of thousands of Pickering residents to walk to do their shopping. There's only one reason that Mitch Goldhar and the folks at the First Professional Group have left the Sobeys and almost a dozen other stores vacant as long as they have. And that's because they decided a few years back that there was more money to be made by taking advantage of the current demand for housing and making a quick buck by rezoning this land from retail to high density housing. What do we as a community get from this planned rezoning? Well, we lose the biggest shopping complex in Pickering. It's going to cost us jobs, and it's going to force Pickering residents to do their shopping in EDAX. We gain the first of what will ultimately be the conversion of the entire property at 1899 Brock Road from retail to housing, with the total number of new units likely to exceed 6,400. Obviously, you don't have to believe me. Look at the edge of the drawing where it says future development. There is no possible way they will not take advantage of the precedent the council would set. If you allow the rezoning of this portion, they will take it as a carte blanche to get rid of the rest of it. And if you don't believe me, speak to the tenants. Lowe's has only 3 years left on its lease. So we're going to immediately get another 1,600 cars making round trips on the Pickering Parkway and Brock Road every day, with that number likely to climb to 6,400 by the time the full conversion takes place. I don't mean to be facetious, but have any of you councillors actually used Brock Road lately, particularly the afternoon rush hour? Imagine 1,600 more cars on top of the 35,000 cars, which will ultimately be added to service the homes being built in this Seton neighborhood, just up Brock Road. And there's only one north-south road they're going to be able to use. What about the quality of the neighborhood the developer would like to force down our throats? Well, let's start with parking. The proposals, in this proposal, they're anticipating 0.8 parking spaces per condo. That means 20% of the residents get no parking space. A property with no quick access to jobs, ironically shopping, once the whole development's gone, or GO Transit. Will the city force the developer to have each purchaser sign a disclosure agreement indicating they're aware there are only 4 parking spaces for each 5 condos? The parking allocation is ridiculously low. This is not a location that will attract the same residents as live near City Hall, an older crowd by and large, and who have a lower reliance on cars. There should be a minimum of 1 space per residential unit plus 2 spaces for each 100 square meters of retail and amenity space. No concession should be made unless the developer makes a commitment to house a car sharing program with its own parking spaces and fund a dedicated continuous bus connection along Pickering Parkway to the GO train. You know, if it wasn't bad enough, the developer would have you believe that magically the residential parking spots are going to free up perfectly in time for the use of the customers in the ground floor retail. The small problem is, in this proposal, the retail store gets only 1 parking space for each 100 square meters, and presumably it's going to have a staff member, so there goes that spot. So effectively, there would be no parking for any customers. Again, will the city insist that retail tenants be required to sign the disclosure agreement that makes it clear there is effectively no parking for their stores? Good luck finding a retailer who will live with that limitation. There's a good reason for a developer to propose this rezoning in stages. On day one, you'll be able to visit the sales trailer and see all the vacant land beside the first two planned buildings. The developer may very well put in a parking lot on the space planned for buildings 3 and 4. What will seem like an abundant parking on day one will, for those that don't look carefully at the fine print, turn into a nightmare once all the buildings are up. And precisely where will the overflow parking go? I see nothing but problems in the future for Canadian Tire and the other properties and the other streets, some of them not particularly close, surrounding this site. The planning rationale for this zoning is non-existent. I actually was involved when the current zoning was put in place. I objected to the loss of the largest convention center in the Eastern GTA. But the city staff and the council at the time, in their infinite wisdom, decided that big box retail shopping was in the best interest of the people of this community. You've endorsed that in every official plan, right up to the most recent one. It defies logic, it defies planning rationale. Why, having just said and continued to say for 2.5 decades of what the best use of this land is to service the entire city, that now you would even countenance the idea of rezoning? The developer has in fact made up an entirely new zoning category with new definitions and new limits that go completely against anything the planning staff and the city have ever allowed in the past. They go against the Kingston Road Corridor plan. They go against the specialty retail node plan. How can the city just last week use those plans to justify the application at Guild Road and Kingston Road and not at the same time categorically reject this proposal? There's a brand new definition of space, in which they remove any consideration of underground square footage. every other development in the city has had to include. There's new limits. Everyone else has to work within a maximum of 2.5 times density, but this project proposes increasing that to 6 times. The current official plan lays out a maximum number of units when you go for a high-rise residential development, but this proposal has the audacity to seek a minimum of 500 units, and they don't base it on net hectare. It's 500 units per gross hectare, over 3.5 times higher than any other building has been allowed to develop in the city. The city can't, even if it has any dream of allowing this, allow a different density than they've just argued as recently as last week for other high-rise buildings being constructed in the city. You can't have two sets of rules for two developers. They've even adjusted the rules on floor space index. The setbacks proposed by this development would prevent completely the future expansion of Brock Road at precisely the time when, again, another 13,000 people will ultimately be living on this lot, and Seton will see over 80,000 people, and almost all of those folks will be using Brock Road. The entire rezoning is an affront to the immediate neighbors and to the broader community. The current use of the land was argued by the current landowner, and we have already lost that convention center and everything it used to attract to the city, because the city and the developer both agreed big box retailing was best. Were we misleading? Were we being misled when we were told that 25 years ago, or are we being misled now? You can't have it both ways, folks. There can't be two best uses of this land. Where's the study showing the impact on taxation revenue by going from retail with its much higher mill rates to residential? Where's the study showing the demand on local schools and other municipal services? Where's the study showing the demand on water and sewage capacity in the area? Councillors, this isn't just another planning proposal. This one has the potential to significantly undermine the quality of life in our community. It will damage the value of our homes. It will cost jobs, and it will permanently restrain the ability for our community to respond to the need to increase retail space as the population of Pickering doubles in just the next few years. If this project isn't killed completely, it will be precisely the inspiration for people to get involved politically come the next election. I can guarantee you that. If there's one thing I've learned, it's that people get very serious about their political choices when their pocketbooks are threatened. And every single urban planning study that you care to consult will show that losing all this retail space will constrain the future increase in value of the homes anywhere reasonably considered as being in this neighborhood. Please, I urge you to take your role to defend the current residents of Pickering and defend their best interests. Please take that seriously and reject this project outright and any future consideration of any residential rezoning on this property. I thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Gilchrist. You didn't really have any questions, just a lot of well thought out comments with respect to the project. But one thing you asked the city to do is to reject this proposal outright. And that's something that we can't do as a city. You know, we have to allow our staff to undergo the planning process. They have to look at all the information, study the reports, consult with all the agencies and stakeholders, and then they can make an informed decision as staff and make a recommendation to council, and council will then decide whether or not to accept the project, reject the project, or maybe ask for some changes to it. So we do have to go through the process, and we went through something similar with the proposal for a two twin condominium buildings at the foot of Liverpool. You know, there was, you know, a lot of people in our community that didn't want it, and they asked us to reject that outright, and we couldn't do it just because if it were to go to the LPAT, the local planning, what was LPAT stand for? I can't remember, but it's the planning tribunal, the local planning appeal tribunal, yes. We just can't go there and say, well, we just reject it outright. No, we have to go through the planning process, allow our staff to do their work, allow our staff to make their recommendation, and then we can make an informed decision. So unfortunately, that's out of the cards for now. So that's the end of our delegates but we do have a couple of questions. I know we don't have a lot of time, but one thing that Mr. Gilchrist asked, as well as Irona emailed us this question, what about schools? So Nilesh, can you talk about the need for schools in these new development applications?
Absolutely, thanks, Mark. Every application that we do receive for residential development, we do engage the public school boards and the Catholic district school boards, as well as the French immersions and any other school boards as part of the planning approval process. They are circulated the application. Each school board will look at it, will look at the number of students that are generated in these developments, and they make a determination as to where those students will be accommodated within those school years. If they, based on their future projections, they feel that there's going to be a substantial number of students, they will then ask the city and work with the developers to look at trying to find land within their site to build for a future school. So there are different mechanisms that we do work with the school boards to determine future student populations and where they would be housed, where they would eventually go, and what schools they would be able to also attend. So part of the review process is certainly engaging the school boards. We're still waiting for feedback from them, and that will be part of the final decision.
Okay, thanks, Nilesh. So we have one more question that wasn't covered yet. This is coming from Margaret. She wants to know, if approved, when would development start and what would the project timeline be? So, you know, there's a lot of people out there that aren't aware of how long the actual planning process is. So Nilesh, can you give us a better idea of how long that process is? And then if council approves it or modifies the plan, when can we expect construction to commence?
Thanks, Mark. Again, it's hard to really put a specific date down and say when construction will begin. We're really early on in the planning approval process. As I mentioned in my presentation, we have the applications circulated out to various internal departments, external agencies. We're waiting for comments, and we still got a number of steps in the approval process, which is statutory public meeting, still providing a detailed response back to the applicant and the applicant to respond back to the city. Typically for a project of this nature or applications for this type development, you are looking at roughly about a year's time before a recommendation report is brought back. And then after that, there are other steps where the applicant would have to prepare a detailed building permit, assuming it gets approved, prepare a detailed building permit. There is a sales program to it, and then obviously a construction period. So I can't speak on behalf of Smart Centers as to when they're looking to get into the ground, but there is a rigorous planning approval process that we do have to go that will take some time to get through the process.
Okay, thanks, Nilesh. Paula, just to finish up with that question, let's say approval is given by the city and construction commences. How long do you expect phase one construction to be?
A project as being proposed right now would roughly be a 2.5-3 year construction period from start to finish. Obviously we're not sure of timing yet, as we are early in the planning process, and we'll have to obviously see how the comments come in and how the approvals proceed.
Thanks, Paula. So folks, thank you very much. This marks the end of our open house, and I just want to thank all of the panelists for, you know, providing some insight to our residents on this project. This wasn't an official statutory meeting, but it was an early and informal opportunity to share a baseline of information to our residents. And as stated many times in this meeting, there will be a statutory public information meeting coming up probably in the fall. So please stay tuned. Go to pickering.ca/devapp or follow us on social media on Twitter and Facebook, and you'll get some key updates from us. But just to reiterate, this is going to be a long process. And at the end of it, we hope to end up with a decision that reflects the collective vision and values of our city. That said, every developer has the right to appeal council's decision on a planning application. And we referenced it before, it's the LPAT, the Local Planning Appeal Tribunal. And we don't like going that route because we want to have all the stakeholders working together to come up with the best plan possible. However, if we can't come to an agreement, then we will defend the city's decision at this tribunal. And I referenced the condo development applications down at Liverpool. We actually won an LPAT hearing for a War Street condominium proposal. So if it has to go that route, it'll have to go that route. But we need to have staff look at the development applications, do all of the studies, their analysis, and then they'll come back to council with a recommendation, and then council will make that ultimate decision. But that's a long time away. As Neela said, it's probably a year. So within that time span, you're gonna have a lot of opportunities to provide your comments, to provide your feedback. We want to engage you, we want to hear from you. You know, you're an important part of this process, and I just want to thank you for being here tonight. Thanks everyone, have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.